And so this afternoon, Professor Paola Bacchetta from Gender and Women's Studies, who, as you know, teaches transnational feminism and works in that area, she will introduce our speakers. What I wanted to say also is that after the keynotes, we'll have a break, I think 15 minutes, and then we will have presentations, creative work by undergraduates who have made a video about the department and its alums and current students. And then we will have a performance art piece by two designated emphasis PhD students in theater and performance studies, and that's going to be a surprise and a treat, so they both will be a treat, to show you how creative we are. Okay, so Paola.
Okay, thank you, Barry. It's so wonderful to just look out and see all of you. You look great, you look beautiful. I hope you would give yourselves a hand right now, please. It's really great to see the professors, the BBRG scholars, all our guests, and everyone all together in the same room for once. It's just fabulous. So thank everybody for coming. I'm going to be brief in my introductory remarks because we'd like to hear from our speakers for a long time. But first of all, I would just like to say that we're delighted and honored to have with us today Professor Patricia J. Williams, who many of our students have read her work, etc. Professor Williams is the James L. Doerr Professor of Law at Columbia Law School of Columbia University, where she's had an academic appointment since 1991. Professor Williams is extremely well known as one of the world's leading specialists on gender, race, and law. And specifically, she works in the area of gender and critical race theorizing, or the consideration and critique of race as a basic and intrinsic component of the juridical realm. She earned her bachelor's degree from Wellesley College in 1972, and her Juris Doctor, from Harvard Law School in 1975. She's a member of the State Bar of California and the Bar of the United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit. Prior to her appointment at Columbia University, Professor Williams held positions as a practicing lawyer as well as academic positions, and she practiced as deputy city attorney at the office of the Los Angeles City Attorney. And she worked as a staff lawyer at the Western Center on Law and Poverty. She was a fellow in the School of Criticism and Theory at Dartmouth College. She served as associate professor at the University of Wisconsin Law School and in its Department of Women's Studies. She's also served on the faculties of University of Wisconsin School of Law, City University of New York Law School, and Golden Gate University School of Law. She's also been on the advisory council for the Medgar Evers College for Law and Social Justice of the City University of New York, the Board of Trustees of Wellesley College, and on the Board of Governors for the Society of American Law Teachers, among many other accomplishments. She's a recipient of the prestigious MacArthur Fellowship, which she held from June 2000 till June 2005. Her academic work is distinguished by the originality and the depth and breadth of her contributions, as well as by her ability to occupy the position of the speaking subject, to speak in the first person, in fact, we might say to witness, since this is what we're going to be discussing today, and even as she proceeds through her various critiques, always in a mode that opens a space for reconsidering the subject at hand. Her books, I'm so sorry, I have only time to name them, and obviously many of you have read them, and those you haven't read, please go and read them. The Alchemy of Race and Rights, A Diary of a Law Professor, The Rooster's Egg, On the Persistence of Prejudice, Seeing a Colorblind Future, The Paradox of Race, Open House of Family, Friends, Food, Piano Lessons, and The Search for a Room of My Own. So I think many of you know that besides the strictly academic appointments and scholarship, that Professor Williams is a public intellectual and a truly feminist people's intellectual. So among other things, she writes a regular column for The Nation magazine entitled Diary of a Mad Law Professor. So please join me in welcoming Professor Williams. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that introduction. It's such a pleasure to be here. I can't tell you how exciting it is for me to be in Berkeley. I used to live here. I miss Berkeley. And I'm really delighted to for the invitation to be here to celebrate the to share in the celebration and to reflect on the last 20 years of this department, not merely a program, and to imagine the challenges as we go forward in a world that is both deeply intransigent around issues of sexuality and gender on one level, and at the same time, so volatile that it's hard to keep up with the changes, and particularly in the areas of technologies of the body, as in reproduction, international surrogate womb, tourism, transgenderism, genetic manipulation, new forms of eugenic inspiration and motivation. So I guess I there was so much to talk about that I thought I would really focus on my own experience or some of my own reflections from the position of being a lawyer over the last 20 years and what has happened. In 1991, I think we had Sandra Day O'Connor, who was considered revolutionary on the Supreme Court simply because she was a woman, not because of ideology or because of ideas. The first lady of the United States was Barbara Bush in 1991. And she sort of represented a sort of range of iconic first ladies from sort of Nancy Reagan to Barbara Bush, you know, bubble hair, red ball gowns, and ropes of thick pearls. For somebody of my age, I graduated from law school in 1975. Somebody whispered just a little while ago earlier this morning that I was dating myself, but allow me to date myself very specifically. But in 1975, I graduated from a law school class in which there were 8% of that class were women. In 1977, 2 years later, my sister graduated from law school, there were 14% in that class. By 1980, 39% of law school classes nationally were women. So things progressed very, very rapidly during this period. In 1980, I started teaching at Golden Gate University, which had the first woman dean, and because it had the first woman dean in the United States. And in 1980, although those numbers were growing among students, there were exactly 6 women of color teaching in law schools in the entire United States, including in traditionally African American universities, the historically black colleges. There were 4 African American women, 1 Asian American, 1 Latina. In 1983, Anita Hill began to teach, and by 1991, 1991, 20 years ago, as of next week, I believe, it is the anniversary of the Clarence Thomas Anita Hill hearings. I think of this as this rich sort of bridge in terms of the coming of age of women's presence in the political and the legal sphere. I was struck this morning when Barry said, when she spoke about looking at backs or having one's back, or feeling exposed or having one's back, because this was also literal. And I was thinking when I actually applied for my job in legal education, it was the meat market of the Association of American Law Schools, and I was walking down a very long corridor, and there were 2 guys behind me, and they were talking the entire way about my legs and about my nether quarters and how very well defined they were, although they didn't quite use those terms. And I remember this was a very, very long corridor, and by the end of the corridor, I whipped off into the interview room where I was supposed to be, only to discover that these 2 guys walked in behind me, and they were the people who were deciding, whether I would get this job or not. And of course, I had to pretend that nothing had happened. And maybe not of course, but I was a very well-trained, good little girl, having graduated from law school with a great deal of investment in wanting to go into teaching. I pretended nothing had happened. And it wasn't until 1991, it wasn't until the hearing of Anita Hill in front of Congress that I began to no longer pretend that nothing had happened. And by 1993, Ruth Bader Ginsburg was on the Supreme Court. During the rest of the 90s, we became obsessed as a culture with the phenomenon of Hillary Clinton, about whether she was going to be Hillary Rodham or whether she was going to be Hillary Clinton, whether or not she baked enough cookies or not, whether or not ultimately she was a good mother or not, even as she demonstrated and was modeling all the while how to raise a daughter, a young woman, who in turn became a thoughtful professional. Her professionalism was masculinized during this period in the crudest terms, and even more recently was all but monsterized as during the last election she became embodied in things like nutcrackers. At the same time during this period, perhaps one of her most famous figurations is that of standing by her man. During this period, we had Elena Kagan between 1991 and 2011. We had Elena Kagan, who was negotiated as a single professional woman, as a woman who actually achieved notoriety in the professions and was not married. Sonia Sotomayor negotiated what it meant to be a wise Latina woman. And so we have 1991 from the Anita Hill hearings all the way to 2011. And I tried to think of what is iconic of the feminist movement and of the challenges and the complexities of this time. And all I could come up was the Dominique Strauss-Kahn and the Nifasitu Jallo case, which is an extraordinarily complicated case. But it does sort of echo a man of power and a woman of color. And it is also a specter and a spectacle of another woman of color, and this time one whose credibility was and is severely in question. And again, for those of you who doubt that, I really recommend, well, the papers did not nearly, I think, give enough attention to the motion to dismiss. It's worth reading to understand the degree to which many of us had the emotional investment of wanting to have a kind of social avenging of the call on behalf of all raped or oppressed women in classed situations. But then this woman was not the ideal heroine, let's put it that way. And again, whether or not she wins her civil case as a criminal matter, I think there was enough to draw into question in terms of presenting it for beyond a reasonable doubt. So the question is whether or not, and a lot of people felt very, very discouraged by that case. And at the same time, I think it was different if it's not, again, a model of progress or an ideal individual case, or if it doesn't represent the ultimate apotheosis of the Anita Hill as some sort of neat bridge. It is at least more complex. It was at least more complex. And it was complex on a number of levels, and if subtle ones. And so I think it's worth going through some of that just to remind ourselves of how different the conversation is, at least, if not that particular outcome. First of all, there were, what I once wrote as a piñata of stereotypes in that case. It wasn't just a woman of color versus a man of power. This one woman was an African woman, not merely African American, reflecting again the demographics of our multiple identities. She was a Muslim woman in a time where Muslim is no longer model minority, but incredibly freighted and fragmented as both heroine, of oppression, of veiled oppression, but also potential Mata Hari, as in this case. It was a mess of images of masculinity, in particular French masculinity, in tension with American Puritanism around images of sexuality. It was a mess of class and labor in tension with images of power, not just white, but related to global monetary policy, women as immigrants, women as asylum seekers. And in that sense, it was a somewhat more sophisticated or globalized discussion of rape, and believe it or not, so much more informed, even if the outcome was, again, a horrible mess. Again, to remind you of what was going on in 1991, the senators in the Anita Hill case, and again, it wasn't a trial, it wasn't rape, but in terms of the discussion of sexual harassment, they didn't get that this might be about the politics of the boardroom, rather than, as Clarence Thomas put it, his bedroom. And to this
To many, this failure to acknowledge even the possibility of a so-called hostile workplace environment was particularly troubling, considering that Thomas, under Reagan, had headed the EEOC, the agency charged precisely with informing policy regarding sexual discrimination. So instead, those hearings were transformed from an inquiry regarding Thomas's fitness to serve on the Supreme Court into a test of whether Anita Hill could prove she wasn't subject to hallucinations. And before the hearings end, Hill would not merely be officially disregarded, but accused of lynching, perjury, incompetence, man-hating, erotomania, feeble-mindedness, vengeance, and conspiracy. So let us not forget that at least that has changed. And when Ginny Thomas called her only a few months ago, or just under a year ago, to ask her to apologize nearly 20 years later, the product, in fact, was a huge national organization to make the 20-year anniversary memorialized in their conferences all around the country. And the product was also a legislative attempt from people like Louise Slaughter to actually turn it back and investigate Thomas's ethics 20 years later. So over the last 20 years, there has been more of an inquiry into the role that men have in being accountable for their behavior in the public space, in the execution of their office, in the hypocrisies of their public positions, in tension with their private behavior. Annette Gordon Reed's wonderful books about Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings have made at the time I first published my book, Alchemy of Race and Rights, in 1991, people told me that I was hallucinating because I mentioned that my great-great-grandfather, who was a slave master and a lawyer, could have impregnated his slave. People simply didn't believe that. In the last 20 years, men like Strom Thurmond, whose black daughter by his maid was finally acknowledged by his family, albeit posthumously after he could be laid to rest. So we are more sophisticated on some level about propaganda. Yes, Bill Clinton was guilty of his indiscretion, but that paled next to the prurience of the Star Commission and that layered understanding of the way in which sex can be used even when somebody is acting inappropriately. Larry Craig, in his denouncement of homosexuality while caught in a wide stance in the Minneapolis airport bathroom, that apparently has since become a kind of shrine. People leave little bouquets there, apparently. Elliot Spitzer, the last in a sequence, and his wife Zelda, the last in a sequence, I hope, of long-suffering wives who stood by her man. After Elliot Spitzer, there was the sort of media input of The Good Wife, the television program The Good Wife, which sort of mocked and made us interrogate the role of the long-suffering wife. And so by the time Anthony Weiner came along, no comment at all. Her wife is not figured as long-suffering. You never see her standing beside his side, but I think rather deliciously, she's standing at the side of Hillary Clinton. But speaking of Weiner, we also have in the last 20 years the role of the internet, revealing both the arrogance of senatorial ethics around sexual behavior, as well as perhaps too many private moments, which then leads us into the consideration of the role of sexting in women's, in the development of young women in particular. Very young women are potentially the victims of a new kind of exploitation, of bullying. Much greater than simply the risks of going bare-breasted at Woodstock, which was my generation. This goes into people's records. It becomes exploited commercially in ways that I think that we will see negative consequences from for years to come. And so in this sense, there has been an opening up of studies from merely about women, but to gender, to men's studies, to whiteness, to female, you know, to feminism as more predominated by Western or white notions, male privilege, global definitions, class, trafficking across boundaries. We've also seen subtle new forms of tokenism, as in the phenomenon or the development of so-called conservative feminism, as perhaps, you know, the mother of all conservative feminists, Lynn Cheney, Cheney's lesbian daughter as a new kind of oddly positioned beneficiary of gender studies, having pried open the closet, yet at the same time overlaid with ultra-libertarian ideologies at this moment that attribute all of that progress to individual choice, ahistorical, mere choice, removed from the social movements that gave rise to those freedoms of behaviors. William Rehnquist's daughter, with her penchant for sidearms, she actually had a human-shaped target in her office that she used for practice for her shooting skills in her workplace. I don't know what this means. I mean, I guess there's no harassment in her office. but this new kind of vigilante feminism that has ultimately, you know, become embodied in people like Sarah Palin, sort of the Thelma and Louise variety of feminism, that actually, you know, justifies a kind of coalesces an element of rage and loss that accompanies, I think, the amount of trauma that really reflects, I think, the trauma of 1 in 3 women having experienced rape in this country, but our lack of legal, prosecutorial, police response to that allows, again, this sense of American vengeance I think that's some part of the identity of what made or makes someone like Sarah Palin or Michelle Bachmann, these no-nonsense, pistol-packing mamas that would, you know, sort of have a Lorena Bobbitt moment and would be cheered in the conduct of their behavior. I think it's also reflective of the fact that Sarah Palin, when she gave her speech at the Republican National Convention, when she was nominated to be vice president or for the vice presidential candidacy along with McCain, actually, according to Time magazine, that speech was written before she was ever selected. And when you actually listen to it from the perspective of imagining a number of candidates auditioning for the vice presidency and try to imagine Lamar Alexander or Mitt Romney giving that speech, it would be a hyper-masculinist kind of talk. And that when you think about who Sarah Palin then became, whether she's a candidate now or not, I think she popularized an image of almost kabuki masculinity in the, you know, with French designer suits, that is a real force to contend with, so that, again, those who are essentialized about what a feminist position is actually had trouble at one point distinguishing between Hillary Clinton's legacy and Sarah Palin just because she was a woman, and therefore we're not going to vote for Barack Obama because a woman is a woman. And it took a moment to step back and you from that particular brink. I'm also struck by the fact that Anita Hill is a friend of mine who began teaching again almost at the, she started teaching a few years, she was like the 7th or 8th woman of color in the country at that time. And I was struck by the fact that Melissa, the student this morning who stood up and said, "What do I wear?" as a kind of ritual, as a kind of respect, or like going into church, has been the subject of so much negotiation over these last 20 years. Anita Hill said when she that one of her biggest challenges, I'll quote it here. She said when she walked into the Senate Judiciary Committee and saw everybody in their dark gray suits getting ready to quiz her, she was struck by a peculiar thought. "I questioned my decision to wear bright blue." And it's almost funny, this climactic moment of sudden entrance onto a world stage, and the anxiety was, did I wear the right thing? Yet the question marked Hill's dawning realization of the powerful media equation of surface presentation with inner substance. What I was thinking was, people are going to judge me for what I wear, and even when there are so many more important things about to happen, there are these profound political judgments made about appearance. Do you look like somebody who is credible, she said. That was her thought. And I do think that kind of basic emphasis on phenotype and on self-presentation and on clothing has metastasized into something very deep that is a that is a different but the same kind of challenge that we're dealing with today. We have as much emphasis on presentation as ever, and it's not just about clothes. We are obsessed with plastic surgery. We even have television programs like The Swan, on the one hand, about beauty, all the way up to the very complex area of transgender operation and transsex operations. And at some level, this is about choice, and on another level, it is about being able to live within our own skins. We are still fighting about clothing, as in veil as choice, or veil as oppression, or no veilness as oppression, that is to say, forced by law, as in the hyper-secularized analysis of France, or as a surveillance precaution, sort of snatch off the clothing so that there are no secrets. Is this liberating or not? At the same time, we are having less visible, but I think no less important discussions. For example, the solicitor, when Elena Kagan, before she was on the Supreme Court, became the first woman Solicitor General. And it's generally not known because we don't televise it, but the Supreme Court requires that this, and by tradition, or did require, that the Solicitor General wear a morning coat. So Elena Kagan had a choice about whether or not to literally wear striped pants and tails when she spoke to the Supreme Court. And the acting Solicitor Generals, those in the past, before her, who had come before, had worn little business suits, and Rehnquist was famous for having gone ballistic because a woman wore a dough brown suit, business suit, into the court. And I think now it's sort of, you know, women wear, you know, they wear suits, they wear black skirts, they wear somber colors. They don't actually have to wear a morning suit. Although most do wear pantsuits. But again, the whole pantsuit thing, do you probably, many of you in this room are too young to remember how much pantsuits were fought over. And certainly, you know, Hillary Clinton described it in the, as recently as the last election, as the sisterhood of the traveling pantsuits. That was a battle to be able to wear pantsuits. And now, you know, I found it very significant in some very ridiculously liberating way that Michelle Obama was able to wear bare legs, bare arms, and still be perceived as professional, to be taken seriously. That at this moment we have a grandmother in the White House, not simply a first lady, as imagistic of expanding notions of nuclear family, of working family, also of ethnic families where extended members live in. That we also have a black first lady as challenging the notion of what it means to be a lady in the White House. In that feminist success 20 years ago was generally getting out of the house and into the workplace, but that was generally an unconsciously white value. White women needed to get out of the house, whereas black women, for many black women of my age, it's getting out of the workplace and into the home not as a domestic, but as a wife and as a mother and as beloved and as beautiful and to have a hunky husband like Barack Obama. Sort of sitting you down and treating you like, you know, like a queen is not progress perhaps for many white women, but it is for, you know, again, in this pantheon of stereotypes for black women. So this is a success too, even if they're on somewhat separate tracks. And so finally, again, you know, this question of wearing our own bodies in issues of sex selection, in vitro selection, of other characteristics, whether or not these are products of social pressures or not, the emphasis on binary designations that makes some lives excruciating, as in the South African athlete who had to be tested, the gender marks of sexiness. We are playing not just with bodies. I think this is a more sophisticated discussion of a realization that this is not simply about male, female. It is about bodies, but it's also about language. It's about cognitive autonomy, about agency, about the signification of identity and community. And I was really, really interested this morning in the discussion of the way in which the linguistics and the syntax of our of gender signification is buried in language. Again, I'm interested in the way in which Sarah Palin, Michelle Bachmann, even the gender politics of the perpetually teary John Boehner, who sobs more perpetually than the weeping Madonnas of old, that this is a sort of play, in, you know, that I think of as a sort of figure of speech, like prosopopoeia, which is a poetic, you know, when Mel Chen and Leslie Salzinger were talking about the discussion of animated stones and inanimate humans, I think of the animation, the abstraction of agency that allows corporations to speak, but also allows people like Sarah Palin and Michelle Bachmann to deliver hyper-masculinist performances, again, while dressed in the drag of, again, what, you know, neoconservative feminism. So I think that these questions of that new knowledge of cognition, language, culture suggests what we might want to incorporate in some of this new knowledge and our strategies for overcoming social disparities and glass ceilings as we describe our paths for the next 20 years. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Professor Williams. I now have the pleasure of introducing our colleague, Professor Trinh Minh-ha, who is Professor of Gender and Women's Studies here in our department at the University of California, Berkeley, and she also has a joint appointment in rhetoric and film. I'm particularly honored to introduce Minh-ha right now because she is the one who thought of the thematic of witnessing, and I think that, you know, that was an excellent idea, and I'm looking forward to the discussion after this. So Professor Trinh, who was born in Vietnam, is a globally renowned filmmaker, writer, and music composer. Her works include 7 films, and I wish I had time to detail every one of them, but I'm just going to be able to name them, and I want you to know that you can get them at the Media Resources Center here on our campus. And many other places, but just for students and things who, if you have not seen them, and I think most of you probably have. But anyway, they are Night Passage from 2004, The Fourth Dimension, A Tale of Love, Shoot for the Contents, Surname Viet, Given Name Nam, Naked Spaces, Living is Round, and Rassemblage. So the films have been given over 42 retrospectives internationally, on every continent. I don't have time to name all the countries, but it's just phenomenal. Professor Trinh has also published 10 books, and they include Elsewhere Within Here, which just came out in 2010, The Digital Film Event, Cinema Interval, Framer Framed, When the Moon Waxes Red, Woman, Native, Other, En Minuscule, which is a collection of poems, Habiter un monde, and Drawn from African Dwelling, African Spaces, Designs for Living in Upper Volta. So her many contributions to feminist theorizing and feminist of color theorizing in particular are too numerous to even begin to mention. I just want to recall one thing that's been extremely salient for me in these particular days is the notion of speaking near, speaking with and near instead of speaking about is just one out of many millions of things that Professor Trinh has brought to us. She's also done 4 large-scale multimedia installations, which I don't have time to go through, and she is the recipient of numerous awards and grants, again, too numerous to cite here. So she's lectured extensively on her academic and filmic work, again, across the globe. And I just want to just stop and ask you to please join me in welcoming Professor Trinh right now. Thank you.
Let me try this to see. Can you hear? I guess it's a bit too close, right? How about this? Is it good in the back? You want it far away? Yeah. But if it's too far, you know, you lose the sound.
If it's too close, it pops really badly.
Oh, okay.
Don't get so close.
How about this? For my ear? Okay. You know, some years ago, I was presenting at a conference at Leeds in the UK. And as soon as I mentioned witnessing as one of the main threads informing my film work, I was typically met, you know, with a response from a male art critic who immediately said, "But we have all read Agamben." You know? So it was as if the notion of the witness began and ended, you know, with Agamben. It didn't even exist before or elsewhere. And it was very interesting this morning, you know, listening to Mel Chen on the notion of animacies. And when Mel was mentioning these examples around stone, I immediately translated to this beautiful notion, you know, of stone witnessing. What would it be like, you know, to be witnessing for a stone, as a stone, you know, so stone witnessing. The witness as a state of consciousness is meant to be used in its widest, most inclusive sense, as well as in its deconstructive reach. As a form of testimony in the feminist struggle, so for example, the position of a third or a between party in a trial, or of the one who has lived through an experience or an event. Coupled with this is the paradox of bearing witness, which has somewhat become familiar to theorists today via the work of Blanchot, Derrida, and Agamben. So here the notion of the witness has been discussed in relation to that of the archive and the remnant. But for me, and perhaps more relevantly for gender studies, it is this related notion of the between space, between what can bear witness and what cannot be borne witness. And I think that these are questions richly debated among Western theorists. Less debated is another dimension of witnessing, widely available in Asian thought and ancient spiritual literature, so that rather than merely pointing the witnessing outward, the movement simultaneously point inward, the here there and the elsewhere within here all at once, so that the focus is not merely on the individual witness and the newsworthy personal accounts, but the different vibrant forms of witnessing, or the nature of witnessing itself. Who's speaking? Who's listening? How? When? Where? With whom? And with what? You know, for example. The epoch of global fear has provoked extreme reactions and sentenced the world to indefinite confinement behind the bars of homeland security, with the political backlash against marked foreigners, foreign-born or foreign-looking members. Asylum and refugeeism remain a key political issue, while immigration, arbitrarily connected to terrorism, has become an explosive matter of voting debate in national politics. Everywhere, migration has shot up the list of governmental concerns. Question arising on the move at the borders, in the encounter with the other, and when stranger meets stranger, all tend to intensify around the problem of the other foreigner and the foreigner within. So someone doubly strange, being paradoxically at once exotic guest and abhorred enemy. In my films and books, I've been working with a large range of figures of otherness, such as the foreigner, the outsider, the stranger, the wanderer, the one who leaves, the exile, the migrant, the voluntary and involuntary immigrant, the refugee. And recently, I focused on the figure of the walker, more specifically, the female walker. Perception, experience, and meaning move with walking. And as it is often said in Asia, what is miraculous is not to walk on water, but to walk on earth. So walking is an experience of indefiniteness and of infinity. Rather than discovering the world as colonialist conquests used to claim, one can say that with each step forward, the world comes to us. With each step forward, a flower blooms under our feet. The spirit of the walk has led me to a whole tradition of independent walkers in ancient Asia, at the same time as it provides me with a link to struggles around the world. It is in this spirit that today's lecture event unfolds. And what you'll be hearing is from a book in progress in which writing finds its way through small and large wounds of our time, as glimpsed through the claims of victory of 21st century colonial wars, and through the critical voices of the people. War offers its lesson of darkness as an irreversible gift of death. The opening setting for the book is a walk during twilight, when events of the world come to the walker in an unplanned, unexpected, albeit tightly interrelated way. It gives the reader an entry into another dimension of research and of production of knowledge, an entry into a very different dimension of war, and features certain aspects of occupation through the deeds of two giants, the US and China. Opening with the ending of the war in Iraq, it unfolds its course across times and territories, involving the wars in Afghanistan, Vietnam, Lebanon, and the transnational struggles of women in the US, Argentina, Mexico, and China. And it ends with the challenge in Tibet, of Tibet in China. So here are just a few touches on what unfolds in the book. Now is the time to take a walk in the twilight, under darkness, until darkness meets the walker in her walk. For years, she has been setting out, moving into the moment of encounter, as if for the first time, with antennas all out. Emotional truths often retreat behind events' factual appearances. Already, she's on her way. No, not the routine march of the two lights, or an ending and beginning binary, but the slow return to primal matter through the very light of transition, a multicolored gray whose time resists capture and whose hues defy every black and white formation. Wondering what might come her way, she heads forth, walks, stands, leaps, stops short, sees not, and sits on the side of the road, waiting until it etches its way under her feet again. In time, she finds herself unwilling by necessity to move fast, always faster, at the accelerated rate of a jet society entrapped by efficiency and productivity, into the non-knowing of every day, there where the path remains unmarked amidst the deluge of markings, she winds her way. Beware of the time of terror entre chien et loup, when wretched dogs are taken for wolves. She must have tried to tell how, in between two lights, one can't be sure what exactly comes into sight. Some things remain inexpressible and all too well said, even to the writer in her twilight walk. Specters of reality appear utterly real to the terrified mind, and naming in such a state is often forgetting the game of hosts and guests on which the name thrives. When it comes to the world of forms, humanity's escape from its own gift in darkness is hard to blame. For who is it who walks by one's side, free and exempt of the depth of time? In the twilight of names, what does one have to say to the other? How long has she let herself be scared senseless by riding the man-made wave of fear? Silence, dust on the road, void. Truly, the one who says it does not know. Yet the possibilities of the word are such that writing, like speaking, often takes the form of a vast absence, whose telling is telling everything at once, including the telling itself. With every step, the world comes to the walker. Enters the time of winning and losing, wartime, the time of hazy definitions of victory. From V to V, language airs, unable to keep still, always awaiting translation and making a silence a way of speaking. Having no memory, writing begins somewhere in the middle, following its own course from silence, producing while identity fluctuates between the all-too-form, the barely and yet to be formed. From V to V, victory restlessly morphs into void as it travels across cybertime and space, in defiance of the very social and cultural boundaries it is made to reify. Arising endlessly at each turn of the road are not questions like who wins or what kind of victory is it, but rather, through what night does victory make its way? Wartime, the time of evanescent asymmetrical victory. The situations with Iraqis is as if one eye is crying and one eye is laughing, said a Shiite leader in Baghdad after US victory was declared on May 1st, 2003. The triumph was short-lived, for what was predicted to be a fast war turned out to be a prolonged, disastrous one. Conflicts over details of the withdrawal marked the evolving relationship between the United States and Iraq. The American administration's sleight of hand in the withdrawal is viewed as yet another lie, typical of colonialism in the 21st century. As it has been reported in the New York Times, the basic operations of dismantling, removing, and transferring surrounding the US troops pullout were all intentionally carried out during the dark of night, when sleep dominates and normal sight is radically limited. Every diurnal gesture has a nocturnal side to it. Day works at its empire, while night constantly threatens to disappear in the bright artificial light of broadcasted acts. To maximize its leverage on key leaders and occupied territories, the dominant would have to see when others cannot see, to see more than what normal situations requires, to see through surfaces and to see even in the absence of light. It advances in adaptive camouflage, concealment, and deception with a high-tech twist, continue to revolutionize an age-old art of warfare. Night vision technology's development was central to what the US military regarded as the preeminent technological advantage they had over their enemies since the first Gulf War. Infrared protection devices are developed that allow American soldiers to disappear so as to be heard but not seen in their night operations, a tactic whose effect on the enemy can be most intimidating. As these new techniques in visual detection and protection show, the occupiers have gone through great expenses, not only to spot without being caught watching, but also to maintain their privilege to see from high above, to see through darkness, and to see whatever man made. Such a stance further expands to seeing in absentia. Unmanned airplanes are being used in the drone war in Pakistan, and these flights with no pilot on board have become, according to a CIA official, quote, the only game in town, close quote. In zones under target, the WASP attack, this is the name given to local by the local inhabitants to the flying robots. So in zones under attack, the WASP attacks have inevitably stirred up the fire of resentment among Pakistani people. Predator technology is aimed forever. Smaller cyber spies or unmanned aerial robots patterned after insects that could fly undetected into places where no human could sneak in to snoop on the enemy. As miniature robots have proven a challenge so far, tests are being carried out on a range of insects whose manipulation via embedded devices would allow them to be recruited in great numbers in order to participate in man's unending wars. Quote, eventually, a swarm of cyborgs could converge on targets by land, sea, and air, close quote. So it is reported. In the dream of imbuing insects or man-made object with the superpower of Iron Man, both aimer and target are dehumanized, and the inhumanly human, dirty work of fighting the enemy at close range would thus be dispensed with. We are made to believe that exterminating via remote control without direct risk to American life is a natural privilege of our high-tech post-human age. But what comes out goes wrong, and with the privilege comes the worry. What if the advantage of the robotics revolution shifts hands? Or what if our favorite weapon is turned against us? So it has been asked among technology analysts. Inevitably, this has already happened, as past historical events have shown. And yet, the threat of this new wave of technology has been yielding no more than a few indulgent reactions, such as that of assuming that its use is an exclusive prerogative of the all-powerful. Whenever the others use it, it is simply said to have fallen into the wrong hands. Today, it is reported that at least 40 other countries around the world have begun to build or buy and deploy unmanned aerial vehicles. When drones attack, civilians die, and all via remote control. Elsewhere, during a lull in the bombings by Israel, which had pounded the town of Tyr in Lebanon, a fisherman warned this is a war of nerves. Don't be fooled by quiet. Be afraid of it. One may start out fighting the far enemy only to realize the need to confront the nearby enemy and face the ever more elusive enemy within. Traitors are said to be lurking within the system, and cutting even deeper into the psyche of our times is the banal saying, evil may be living just around the corner. In the return of dark age violence via new technology, it is globalization at its most divisive that thrives on as the world is conveniently reduced to winners and losers. When the flag of security threat goes up, many are made to feel edgy. And if a person screams, everyone runs, scaring each other literally to death. Overnight, the entire world comes to be populated with foes. Havens of safety seem to be shrinking in proportion to one's effort to recover them by force. Time to go home. One sees a potential enemy everywhere one looks, and one startles at every shade and shadows that come one's way. Going home, one feels no longer at home. Whenever the face of victory shows up, it morphs to let one catch a glimpse of death in the survivor. The war on terror would be made to last as long as possible, for too many livelihoods, directly or indirectly, depend on the sustainability of the US war machine. Toni Morrison was voicing a rather popular concern when, right after the fall of the Twin Towers, she warned us of the peculiar smell of money rather than morality that the invasion of Afghanistan carried. And smell was what also led, some 6 years later, a civilian from Houston, Texas, to comment, quote, "The Bush administration has taken politics from the gutter into the sewers," close quote. May it rebel, that nerve of life. May it twist and throb. Clarice Lispector wrote in The Stream of Life. The war of nerves is also a war of words, an info war, and a verbal struggle, as Mao used to call it, a raw red place where words are bled of substance. He lied, they died. Red and anti-Bush button. Deeper in the red, immaterial forces continue to steer strife and conflict. The heart goes on listening. Spectral voices re-emerge on her walk. They die for a lie. So the signs on the road read, "Till they all come home," said a magnet stuck in between two bumper stickers of a mother's car. Or, "Walk in their shoes," urge a public installation of shoes of all size from the dead in Iraq. Sadly, it didn't really end. It never really was over, murmur disconcerted soldiers' voices in echo. The Irish metaphor for the term battle comes in her way, notably showing a tangle of bodies, a web of men killing one another and dying. It's this strange thing. "He came home, but he's not home at all," commented a soldier's wife. "Murder is a crime. What's war?" asked a woman in black placard. All around the country, and across nations at war, code pink messages read, "Women say pull out, stop the next war now. Diplomacy, not drones. Mothers say no to war. Democracy is a feminist agenda. And peace is creative. While a broad cross-section of Americans continue to voice their resistance to the war mindset, and military moms no longer shy away from raising questions loud and clear in public, on the other side of the battle, on the other side of the battle line, fresh enemies are being continuously created who vow to match insanity with greater insanity. Stories of wounded humanity are told many times over, and yet they remain illimitable. The time of uncertainties is also a time of daily bewilderment over what matters most to civilized people. One is reminded of the animal energy that makes a man bark ferociously, every time a stranger or a foreign-looking passer happens to walk by. History seems to be nothing else but conflicts of unstable bloods, war after war, and all this war on, war against, as if life is all about killing and lying on top. Life appears then in a stringless words, visionless, landless, homeless, humanless, and above all, heartless. A dot on the screen of live events leads her to a more specific date. On March 8, 2003, International Women's Day, the White House was unexpectedly given a color and encircled in pink. Over 10,000 participants came to celebrate a global peacemaking force initiated by a women grassroots movement. While the administration's color-coded alerts used to be based on classified degrees of manufactured fear, the code pink alert, which calls for people to wage peace, takes as its base of action kindness, compassion, transnational alliances, as well as humor and creativity. The color, and we heard that this morning, right? The color, a seemingly universal girly color, may at first appear as heavily gender-coded and harmlessly decorous. But pink comes in many tints and tones. And the question remains politically, which pink? What would pink feel like in its mature phase? In the mature phase of the struggle, laugh while you act, march, protest, provide if you can, and care. Gathering both the male and female energies of white and red, the colors of new beginning and of passion, pink in its deeper shades has proven to be most effective in prisons and police cells, for example, in diffusing aggressive and destructive tendencies arising from fear and friction. Feminism is the new funny, so it is said by those involved. The movement's manifold activities differ according to circumstances and contexts. They run anywhere from the usual acts of civil disobedience to wearing pink of many shades, festive hats, and bright gloves. Delivering pink slips to the administration's highest-ranking warlords who fail to serve the people. Distributing certificates of shame to the dirty dozen, those congressmen and women who had the worst pro-war voting records. Dressing as pink nurses and doctors for peace to demand health care instead of warfare. Moving in vibrant parades in front of the Justice Department, the Internal Revenue Service, and the Capitol, asking to restore the Constitution, paying tribute to mothering around the world on Mother's Day, or to fathering on Father's Day, and last but not least, offering educational workshops at their DC Pink House during the summer. Today, Codepin continues to fight fiercely against war and abuses of power. Despite the vicious attacks it has undergone since its creation in November 2002, it has become a worldwide network of workers, walkers for peace and social justice. With an impressive and creatively expansive range of program areas, and with 250 active, decentralized local groups around the country and the world. The power of Pink, as initiated by women in the US, seems to carry at its core a long history, predating their formation. It calls to the mind, the struggles of bereaved mothers and grandmothers around the world, such as the renowned cases of the women of Juarez and Chihuahua cities in Mexico, and of Las Madres de Plaza de Mayo in Argentina. Both struggles are probably well-known cause to this audience. And what I have to say about them comes from a situated site, defined both by outsidedness and the contextual writing of this lecture. Here, as I see it, in a reverse scenario of color energies, the silent walk around the plaza started on a historical Thursday afternoon in April of 1977 by a group of 14 mothers in search of their missing sons and daughters, has continued ever since to become a vital part of Argentina's modern history. The recurring scene is at once familiar and strange. To challenge the government, women young and old persist in walking quietly together every week for half an hour, wearing white bandanas, recalling the diapers of their missing babies, covering their head in white scarves as symbolic doves of peace, or dressed in dark colors with conspicuous plain white gloved hands in their fight against the so-called dirty war. Las Madres, whose sensuously striking marches for over three decades are known to the world, were thus encircling and dotting the Plaza de Mayo with white signs of motherhood, peace, and integrity, right in front of the vividly pink presidential palace in downtown Buenos Aires. Although practical reason explained it as a vernacular technique of wall finish that mixes paint with cow's blood. Wasn't La Casa Rosada's color also said to have been chosen by President Sarmiento to diffuse political tensions as it symbolically blended the red and white colors of his nation's official opposing parties? It was in plain sight of the Pink House that Las Madres made their silent suffering public, and it was their love, courage, and steadfast endurance that ended up changing Argentina's political course by setting an unusual precedent for other political dissents to make themselves heard, until the military government itself toppled. Today, although the mothers are being scrutinized because of their alliances and their activities being questioned, their walk reaches far and wide, attracting visitors of all kinds. In a much advertised tour of southern exploration, tourists are informed that if you arrive at the plaza on a Thursday afternoon during your Argentina tours, you may meet Las Madres and buy t-shirts and other items that support their efforts. The call of the disappeared continue to haunt and move women around the world. It gains in new resonances as it spread and intensifies across the continent, leading the way to the Mexican cities of Juarez and Chihuahua. the killing fields for young women and the site of over 400 unresolved femicides. One recalls how on November 25, 2002, more than 1,000 women clothed in black marched through Mexico City, mourning the death of the innocent female victims and protesting the indifference of the authorities involved in the investigation. More recently, on International Women's Day 2008, mothers of femicide victims and their supporters again took to the street. Despite the promises of public officials and the rooting out of large amount of suspects, some of whom were policemen, more disappeared bodies continued to turn up in the desert. Again, it was through the tireless digging of the mothers searching for their daughters and the tenacious struggle for justice of the victims' families that national and international attention was drawn to the situation, which governments on both sides of the U.S.-Mexico border have been trying to cover up. Each time a new victim emerges to visibility, the wounds open anew, and the trauma deepens among terrified mothers and relatives of the disappeared. With body counts increasing, and little protection from the government, Ciudad Juarez, the bustling city across the border from El Paso, has come to represent the contact sore between two mutual corruptions and exploitations, two cultures unequally bound in ruthless material production, plunging headlong into social regression through an economical border system that ends up devouring itself. The mother effect has a humanizing impact that continues through love to inspire a kind of mad courage across borders and nations. Again and again, they dig in the earth and search there where no one in their ordinary mind believes it is realistic to go any further. By the sheer force of love for their lost ones, women in many parts of the world have learned to turn grief into struggle, a quietly persistent work for justice and truth that more often than not looks like a beating of one's head against the wall. The Tiananmen mother's costly act of remembering in China is an example. In their call for a process of truth and reconciliation, Mother Courage demands not only apologies from the government, okay, it's good to cut short. Let me see if I have any. Okay, so you know, to just to give you an outline, you know, of what comes next, is that after I was talking about the struggle of the mothers of the Tiananmen Square. And then it goes to, finally, you know, to the work of Maya Ying Lin and the wall, what is called the wall of shame, the black ditch, right, which is that marking, that scar in Washington that reminds us, you know, all the time of the war in Vietnam. And so the weeping, actually the paper ends with a kind of weeping that is that doesn't care about whether who is looking or what is happening and so on. And as Suzanne Murphy would say, the feminine is always an untidy fit in this present world. Thank you.
To invite both speakers then to come and sit here so that we can now have a dialogue. So I hope that you have questions, comments. Please go to the mic to speak, which is right there in the middle of the two aisles. We have a little bit more than 10 because the other thing is shorter. Okay, we'll have a few questions then. It looks like we have 10 minutes.
Hello, my name is Zan, and thank you very much, both of you, for some amazing talks. I guess my question can be for both of you, but it comes from a memory from June of 2005 in Wellesley College, where you you said that we needed to have optimism and resilience in your graduation speech. And it's been really hard to keep optimistic in, especially after listening to what you had to say, Professor Trin. Do you have any tips on being resilient and optimistic? Thank you.
This will sound a little bit counterintuitive, but I actually think that part of the American character has been, you know, we are going to feed the world, we are, you know, the Coca-Cola commercials, you know, kumbaya. And I actually think that's been, that our optimism, our very optimism, has been some of the blindingness that has allowed us to mask the you know, the horrendous foreign policies that were just discussed, and also some of our most horrendous domestic failings, with a sense that tomorrow is always brighter, that the next day is, you know, that we whistle while we work, and I do think that if we feel some pessimism at this point, it's a better thing than not. Because I think too much of our, you know, particularly post-World War II history has been wrapped in a kind of false optimism that's also quite blinding. So I think that that as disorganized as that consciousness and that fear and that distress that we feel as Americans at this moment, I think it actually connects us to the global disease that was perhaps more invisible prior to 9/11. And I think that that's, again, an opportunity, not only a, you know, the scales falling from our eyes in some way that should leave us paralyzed.
I guess in my case, I would say to continue on the question of scales falling from our eyes, you know, there are many ways, you know, to break with the duality between what is visible and what is invisible. And I think that most of the time, you know, because we tend to limit ourselves to what is most visible, it has been very frustrating, and especially in terms of question of war, for example, we tend to feel hopeless, we tend to feel guilt, we tend to feel shame and all these emotional truth, you know, that we cannot circumvent. But I think that if you do not limit yourself, if material or the visible reality is only part of a reality, right? Reality is so much richer, so much more infinite than what we confine ourselves in. And that means that whatever you do, I have this image, you know, that I refer to. Whatever you do, it's like a drop of ink that you put in a glass of water, and the bare eye cannot see the effect of it. But certainly, the whole water in that glass has changed. So whatever one does, you know, on a very small scale, you know, if one does not view it simply as this fragmented part that is always looking for the whole, but rather that in what one does, in the fragment, you find the whole, then I think that there's little reason to despair. Everything you do has an impact, especially in a situation where, you know, you can see with political events around the world, how one what happened in one part of the world reverberates entirely to other parts of the world. Mm-hmm. So I think this is part of what allows one to go on, right? The struggle.
Since there's no other question, let me follow up on that. I also think that our sense of, you know, what is a small contribution is perhaps, you know, it's not as small as we would imagine. I mean, particularly most of us in this room as, you know, people who are, if not American, part of, you know, having some participation in the wealth that is still America. There's a lot of disappointment in terms of the heretofore described endless gold of the American dream. But I think that the myth that we were going to change the world is part of the arrogance of the American dream. I'm sort of come out of a Quaker tradition, and one of the things that George Fox said, you know, is that, you know, we're not going to change the world. And it's an arrogance to think that you can go and everything is, and we can enter something like Iraq and make a change that's going to change an entire culture. And that to be more modest about that. I mean, and if you can't change the world under those metrics, you're always disappointed and you're even paralyzed because you just feel like you've betrayed yourself. But if you have a more proportional sense, and it's not a small sense, it's a human sense of what we can do as human beings, then you can count having changed one person's mind in the course of a year or even a lifetime, like that drop of ink in the water, as being extraordinarily powerful and repercussive, and appreciate that for its power rather than diminishing oneself for not having done some miracle.
So I wanted to thank both of you for these brilliant, brilliant keynote speeches. And actually wanted to bring them two together, just like the last questioner had done. And my question to both of you is, how do we walk and weep with the mothers who have lost their children? And for the people here who have lost their souls when they press a button and are responsible for murder of hundreds of thousands in my country and in my neighboring countries, how do we convey those messages? How do we walk together with Michelle Obama and her husband? How do we stop those little signatures that allow the genocide of our people? Thank you.
It's the first thing that comes to mind is actually I don't know, on Wednesday, my deepest mentor, Derek Bell, died. And so I'm thinking about how to mourn him and how to feel the depth of that loss. So it has to filter through that. And I think that one of the most interesting moments I had around mourning was years and years ago, around a friend who was murdered, actually, this is Mary Jo Frug. At one point, when one of her Palestinian former students came to a room of us who were sitting together and mourning, this Palestinian woman walked in the door. And she fell on the floor, and she immediately began to ululate and cry and beat the floor. And then suddenly she stopped, and she realized that there was silence in the room, and everybody was sort of staring at her. And she looked up, and she said, "What's the matter? Don't you mourn in this country?" And I do think that a big part of, you know, the difficulty with this moment in time is that we don't know how to mourn. And that we also live in a country where there is tremendous trauma, even before one gets to what is going on with drones and with death and with the war, that we are, you know, we have a huge murder rate, a huge crime rate. We have people who are supposed, and we have a philosophy of just getting over it.
And I think that there must be something in the social psychology that accounts for our inability to do anything but put distance between us and the traumas, to put it behind us. I mean, these are cliches. And perhaps the American, I don't know, if I want to generalize it to a Western phenomenon, but I do think that it is part of our tradition not to adequately mourn. And when somebody, you know, fully expresses the horror by screaming and ululating and crying and keening, we call them banshees, or we are terrified by that, and we suppress it yet further. And we're only beginning to grapple with the inappropriate eruptions around that, which include, in my mind, things like the applause that came at the numbers of Rick Perry's executions. That's a kind of buried societal sense of vengeance against all the harms and the hurts and the deaths that we have suffered, but we express it in the most horrible backwards out the back door kind of way. So I think that there's a lot of self-examination that can go before we can even have a coherent conversation about the invisible, impersonal, drone-like deaths that occur at the geographic distance, never mind just the emotional distance of what occurs that's horrible right next door.
The question is really related to the previous question. And I'll come back to the question of visibility, invisibility, and avisuality, and so on. In that, yes, I can answer you. Maybe there are two ways to answer, right? One way is to say there's a big difference between learning how to walk only with people whom you can see, and learning how to walk including the disappeared. So walking with the disappeared, walking with what you cannot see, what you cannot know in advance, and what you cannot define in advance. So there's that way, to point to a form of walking. And it's very related to this other form, which I would begin by asking, do you know how you walk? Do you know how you walk? Yeah, it's, sometimes, we want to walk very nicely, right? Especially in public. You don't want to stumble and fall on the stage, for example. But what happens if you fall on the stage? Well, we can dwell in that falling. Or we can walk with our weakness, right? We walk with our strength and we walk with our weakness. And I think this is part of also of the self, inquiry, that if you don't know your walk, then the question of how should we walk would just remain suspended. You have to come back to where you are, to exactly the place where you are in order to walk.
Thank you. Are there any more questions? We have about 5 minutes left. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. Barry, please tell Barry.
I have a question related to the notion of the walker, and it kind of builds off the other questions. Just about letting the world come to you, and just about, before one can start to think about places that are elsewhere, and what happens when we put up walls between me and you, and how that is destructive. I'm really thinking about putting up a wall inside of ourselves and between like me and myself, and speaking about the remote control and pressing a button, and that leading to things being post-human, how that also leads to people being inhuman inside themselves. And especially the title of your book, Elsewhere Within Here, that could speak to both within here as in there being so many elsewheres of diversity within the United States, but also like coming to terms within your own elsewhere inside of yourself, like seeing being in your own body, but also being inside of other people's simultaneously, but being you first, and just like what that means and the compassion that that means that you can have for others if you have compassion for yourself first. So I didn't know if, I thought that that kind of, for me, that's had like great meaning for how we can deal with, how I can deal with what's going on in the world is like me first, then others, and then like my community. So I didn't know.
One of the things that comes to my mind as a lawyer is how much, for example, law, which is supposedly also about justice, which is about the Constitution, which is about constitutive communities. This is supposedly about a vocabulary of connection. I mean, that's what law is at its best. And it's been increasingly taken over by very econometric metrics. And at the heart of the econometrics and the law and economics, certain parts, certain strains of law and economics, is hyper-libertarian, not just hyper-libertarian, hyper-individualistic, at the heart of which is homo economicus, not woman economica, but homo economicus. So it's gendered even from the get-go. But it's also really in a way that we frequently put on technology, but it's also post-human in some ways because it has a figuration that's almost like an automaton. I mean, that's and it really goes back to certain vocabulary of just over the last two centuries of automatic, it's an abstracted human being that has very few transaction costs, very few interactions with the rest of the world. And increasingly, I think we have a vocabulary, a political vocabulary, that has seeped through the media, not just in law, but also in many of the social sciences, of discrete individuals who are, only responsible for themselves, not connected to anybody else. And it becomes more and more, Ron Paul talks about, letting the grandma die because she didn't choose to distribute the costs or plan for the costs of her own coma. But you also have very interesting, complex examples of how this vocabulary affects people, not just ideologically, but emotionally. When you think about Glenn Beck talking about the pay to spray, do you remember the pay to spray? This man, Gene Cranick, who was living in an unincorporated territory of Obion County, Tennessee, and his house burned to the ground, and because he hadn't paid the $75 for the fire department to come from the city to this unincorporated part, the fire department actually came, sprayed down the houses around him who had paid their $75, and watched his house burn to the ground. The fire department just sat there. I don't know if you saw this on TV. And Glenn Beck talked on and on about how the fact it's not about the fire, it's not about, it's not about, it's about the $75. So the entire relationship of a fire gone wild, knowing no boundary, indeed the positioning of fire, health, policing, which is usually part of community resources, the spreading of costs, because we feel for our fellow human beings and because we don't want, our houses to burn down and the dogs and the cats that were in this house, gets completely suppressed because it's only about the $75 and it's only about the individual, the pressing of the button of the $75, which would have then have permitted you to get this particular resource. It's all reduced to a cash on the barrel head, contract transaction, not a constitutional, social, even tort, it's not part of the larger society. It's all about a non-human, automatic, econometric insurance transaction. And I think that infuses much, much of our thinking about war, about crimes, about torts, and again, things that used to be in the more social, moral categories of law and subjects of law, but increasingly all of our Constitution is being understood and redescribed in the singularized, individualized, non-human, but rather atomistic vocabulary of the econometric, not even the economic, but the econometric. I think that shapes our vocabulary in weird, weird ways. When we were talking about linguistics this morning, there's a wonderful linguist at Stanford named Lyra Boroditsky, and she talks about the way, and she sort of revives the old, formerly discredited Sapir-Whorf theory, but she actually can prove it empirically. For example, in French and Spanish, the word for bridge is masculine, and in German, and it's feminine. And so in countries that speak Romance languages, bridges tend to be described as muscular and strong, and they do their duty. Whereas in German, where it's feminine, the same bridge will be described as elegant and beautiful, and it arcs through the air in the most beautiful kind of way, and that channeling of our thoughts that's gendered, I think, ultimately we'll be able to show that we also have, that certain words are raced, like the president is an unconsciously raced construct, so that I think that's why, Barack Obama, when he occupies that space, is suddenly foreign, alien, whether he's like from Mars or from Kenya, he's not, it violates the unconsciously raced and gendered vocabulary that we have. So in that sense, I think that this incredibly ultra-libertarian, ultra-econometric vocabulary is, our vocabulary is, we don't have genders in English in the same way that we do in many other languages, but we are unconsciously gendered around certain kinds of, a doctor is still in many people's minds masculine rather than feminine. A lawyer is the same. A president is white rather than black. And I think that when we have a vocabulary that is atomistic, we eliminate the social connections that make the American dream a connective one rather than a hyper-individualized one or a post-human one as well.
Thank you. I regret to say that we're out of time. That was a fabulous discussion. I want to again thank our two speakers, Professor Patricia Williams and Professor Trinh Minh-ha, for brilliant talks.